When I drive a car with a straight six engine, I often talk about how it feels much smoother than a four. It's not just me either, you often read the same thing in car magazines. I'd always assumed that it was simply that more cylinders meant that the ignition fired more times per engine revolution, but it turns out there's a lot more to it than that, and it's quite interesting stuff. So in this video, I'll show you why that is. It was actually quite a quest to find an explanation of all this that wasn't filled with talk of sinusoidal envelopes and secondary harmonics. So I waded through a whole load of engineering engine stuff, and to help me understand it and hopefully to explain it, I drew some pictures on the computer. Let's start at the beginning. We've got a piston and a crank, which is mounted centrally on a crankshaft. The crank is connected to the piston by a connecting rod, which pivots on the crank off-centre so that when the piston is pushed down, it makes the crank rotate around the central crankshaft, which, spoiler alert, goes on eventually to drive the road wheels via the gearbox and the final drive, and therefore move the car. Most cars use a four-stroke cycle. Induction moves the piston downwards to suck in the mixture of fuel and air via the open inlet valve. I haven't shown the valves here, but you can imagine. Compression moves the piston up again to reduce the volume of the combustible gas and increase its heat. Ignition is the cycle where the gas explodes and forces the piston back down again, the power cycle. And finally, the exhaust stroke pushes out the leftover smoke through the open exhaust valve, ready to start again. Induction, compression, ignition, exhaust. Or as most engineers I know would say, suck, squeeze, bang, blow. All this banging and stroking and sucking offers lots of potential for various sorts of vibration in the engine, as well as being a very rich source of double entendre. Vibrations are caused by imbalance, and there are three main kinds of imbalance inside a piston-driven internal combustion engine. The first imbalance is probably the easiest one to explain and the most intuitive, and that's simply the length of time between each time the ignition fires. Pretty much every car engine under the sun has the ignition points for all the cylinders spread equally around the cycle, so this isn't generally a problem. There are some motorbike engines that don't have even timing, like this Triumph Tiger 900, but that's a whole other can of tigers. So we're taking even ignition timing as a given, but that sets us up for the second cause of potential vibration, which is rotational imbalance, which is the force that tends to rock the engine from side to side. Let's say we want to design a four-cylinder engine for silky smoothness. So we arrange the pistons evenly around the crank every 90 degrees like this to balance out the rotational forces nicely. And here's our even ignition timing as well. Now, let's fire cylinder one. Fine. The next piston at the top for the second bang is on cylinder three. But now we have a problem. For the third ignition stroke in the cycle, the piston that's top dead centre is number one again, which we've already fired, and it's now wanting its induction stroke. Cylinders 2 and 4, meanwhile, aren't getting a look in. This is an impossible engine. The only way we can make it work is to arrange the pistons in opposing pairs, like this. Then the engine can run, with a fairly conventional four-cylinder firing order of 1, 3, 4, 2. But the problem is that when one pair of pistons is in the top half of its travel, the other pair is in the bottom half. Why is that a problem? Well, because each piston travels faster in the top half, and therefore with more force, because it's mainly moving vertically. In the bottom half of its run, the crank end of the connecting rod is also busy moving sideways as it loops around the centre of the crankshaft, so there's much less vertical motion of the piston. In an inline four, at any given moment, the two pairs of pistons are travelling at very different speeds, and the forces are pushing in different directions that don't cancel each other out. But now let's see what happens when we add another two cylinders. We still need to arrange the pistons in pairs to make the even four-stroke timing work, but this time the cranks are at 12 o'clock, 4 o'clock and 8 o'clock instead of at opposite points. And what this means is that when one pair of pistons is travelling rapidly downwards, another is accelerating upwards, while the piston rods of the third pair are going round the bottom of the crank. And in fact, all of those forces perfectly balance each other out in an inline six. The six has another advantage here too. With the four-cylinder engine, with the pistons at opposite extremes, the power stroke of one has to come to a complete stop before the power stroke of the next can start. In a six, the power strokes overlap. Because the crank rotates 180 degrees during each stroke, but the pistons are connected every 120 degrees, the crankshaft still has a third of its power stroke travel left when the next piston is fired. So as the rotating power from one piston diminishes, the next one comes in without waiting for it to run out completely. So that smooths out the action and it puts less reliance on a heavy flywheel or counterweights to keep things spinning evenly. The third main challenge for smoothness is called reciprocating imbalance. Basically, this is the punching motion of the pistons rocking the engine back and forth, as you can see in this inline triple. When the piston at one end is pushing down, the one at the other end is not pushing up at the same time to balance it out. So there's a rocking couple around the midpoint. Both the inline 4 and 6 score very well on reciprocating imbalance. They both have an even number of pistons, so the position and therefore the mass and forces of the pistons in the front half of the engine can mirror the ones in the back half, as long as we arrange them symmetrically like this. And this is where the inline 6 scores over its V6 cousin. A V6 is basically two 3-cylinder engines merged around a shared crankshaft. So each bank of cylinders has a similar asymmetry to the triple. The matching piston from the 6 is still there, of course, but it's on the other bank, so its balancing forces are displaced by the angle of the V. So how come we aren't all driving around in straight 6 cars and revelling in the silken smoothness? Well, the trouble is that that smoothness comes at a price, and that price is extra weight. It's not brilliant for fuel economy. The crankshaft is longer and therefore has more strain from the torsional forces along it, and therefore needs to be more robust. The straight six is not just heavier, it's also longer than an inline four or even a V6. That makes it harder to fit between the wheels of a transverse engine car, although some, like the Leyland Princess here, have managed it. And mounted lengthways for rear-wheel drive means the car will have a longer nose. My little BMW 320i here has quite a short nose, but then it predates the time when Euro NCAP and so on decided that it was no longer okay for your legs to form part of the crumple zone. And if you're shouting at the screen that your modern turbocharged four-cylinder car, or V6, is plenty smooth enough, then please stop shouting, because you're probably right. But that's thanks to other engineering solutions, like balancer shafts or eccentrically weighted flywheels. Technology has found a way round the inherent shortcomings of the inline four. So as the internal combustion engine gets legislated out of existence, the inline 6 survives with only a handful of manufacturers, most notably BMW. So I think it's well worth understanding and appreciating and preserving its elegant engineering simplicity in cars like these. And on that note, if you want some more smooth and silky straight six action, then I recommend you watch this video next.